This is Ezekiel O'Callaghan with Raptor Chatter. Today we're going to be going over January 18 paleontology. This year in paleontology started off very well, with the study on Nothosaurus from the Netherlands. A sister group to what would become the plesiosaurs, this study helped to show the beginnings of what would become one of the most dominant groups throughout the Mesozoic oceans. The analysis of the skull of the specimen showed that it had a lack of strongly developed senses like smell or hearing, but it did have well-developed eyes and a well-developed pineal sensor, the third eye seen in some reptiles today. Because of this, it makes it much more likely that the nothosaurs and their relatives took to the water in the early Triassic, being ambush predators in the shallow seas of the time. The first bird tracks coming from Cretaceous Tibet were also described in January. The Ichno species, which is a species known from trace fossils such as footprints or burrows, resembled a species already known since 1969, Korean Ornis. However, this is the first vertebrate fossil to come out of the Cretaceous rocks of Tibet, and so could be the first of many finds that are new to science. Birds use colors for signaling, and recently we've been able to find the colors of some extinct dinosaurs and birds. For example, Inkayacu was an ancient penguin that was much more brown and gray than we'd expect from the normal tuxedoed look of modern day penguins. Now we may be able to tell how the dinosaurs and birds may have been able to see each other. For the first time, a Chinese fossil has shown soft tissue preservation from the eyes. Crystallized oil droplets have been found inside the cones of the fossilized eye. In modern birds, these oil droplets are used to help the bird see and perceive color in different ways, depending on the size of the oil droplet. Because of the wide variation in oil droplet sizes we have in the fossilized eye, it makes sense that these ancient birds and extinct birds would be able to see in color and in full color, just like their modern day counterparts. Lepidoptera may sound like a tropical disease, but it's actually the family of insects which contains butterflies and moths. Nectar eaters today, it's believed that these species had evolved during the propagation and spread of the first flowering plants during the Cretaceous. However, microfossils of wing scales found in the early Jurassic of Germany show that the Lepidopterans must have evolved in the late Triassic, adding at least 70 million years to the time that they evolved. Now, while there weren't flowering plants there, it is still believed that these species would have fed on nectar. However, this nectar would have been secreted as drops by the seed-growing plants of the time period, and also would have acted as a water source during the very dry Triassic. A study on tetrapods during the Permian Triassic extinction showed that their distributions shifted 10 to 15 degrees towards the poles. This was following massive global warming, with the oceans at the equator reaching over 40 degrees Celsius. Because of the global warming, life was restricted to the cooler latitudes of the planet, increasing competition and decreasing habitat. Once the cooling started and the equatorial latitudes opened back up, it was fair game for any creature that could get there and fill niches quickly. This helped the dinosaurs, with their upright posture, become dominant on the planet. Massospondylus was a basal sauropodomorph, hailing from the early Jurassic. Known since its discovery in 1854 by Sir Richard Owen, Massospondylus represents one of the longest known dinosaurs from this time period. Due to debates on where Massospondylus should be placed within the sauropods, a study was organized to look at CT scans of the skull to understand the evolution and differences between different species of early sauropods to understand where exactly Massospondylus should be placed. The conclusion of the study was that due to unique evolutionary designs inside the skull, Massospondylidae should stand as its own clade. Additionally, the researchers released the model of the skull for free online, meaning that now you can 3D print your own dinosaur skull. Link in the doobly-doo. An ornithopod dinosaur has been described from a tail and leg from Australia's Eumerella Formation. The formation has been interpreted as a 600 meter wide river that was at least 25 meters deep. Now, coming from Arizona, any river with water is a strange thing to me, and any river over 20 feet is downright scary. The research on this river formation is still in its early phases. However, the partial ornithopod dinosaur that drowned here over 112 million years ago indicates that future searches in this area could prove fruitful. In addition, it's helped to illuminate the evolution of the southern dinosaurs, as the species found has a different number of tail vertebrae than other closely related species from the dinosaur co-formation, potentially indicating a transition from this species found in the Eumerella Formation to Antarctic species such as Morosaurus. researchers in New Zealand uncovered a large bat dating from between 16 and 19 million years ago. Named Vulanops, the study showed that it probably belongs in the same family as New Zealand's modern-day short-tailed bats, Meistensinidae. While modern species roost in tree hollows despite foraging on the ground, it's believed that this bat species was so large that it couldn't fly at all, instead burrowing for safety. Additionally, it helps to shed light in how the only flying mammals spread around the world and how mammals spread from Australia across the sea to New Zealand. When thinking of animals that use tails as weapons, you're probably thinking of dinosaurs, with things like Stegosaurus having its stagomizer or Ankylosaur tail clubs. However, there were other species that also had this kind of weaponry. In the Pleistocene 2.5 million years ago, Glyptodons evolved spiked tails, and in the Mesozoic, some sauropods also evolved clubs that resembled those of the Ankylosaurs. Additionally, there was a group of prehistoric turtles that evolved hardened tail bones to use for defense. With the exception of one species, Smog, an African lizard, all of the animals that have these tail weapons have a number of traits in common: large size, armor plating, and herbivory. Due to these kinds of adaptations being found in multiple groups spread across many millions of years of evolution, it makes sense that this kind of adaptations would evolve and have the prerequisite of requiring herbivory, large size, and armor. And so it's likely that we will see this adaptation again because it has shown up so many times in the fossil record. However, the authors also note that it probably won't show up soon due to our current day lack of heavily armored large herbivores. The Permian Triassic extinction wiped out over 90% of life in the oceans. And this has been attributed to the eruptions of the Siberian Traps, a series of volcanoes that raise temperatures and release CO2 into the waterways. However, a study of ammonites coming from Iran indicates that there may have been multiple smaller extinctions just before the main Permian event. Combined with evidence from other regions, the authors suggest that there may have been a wider spread deterioration of environments before the final Permian event and eruption sealed the extinction. Unbeknownst to them, NASA scientists had been walking over dinosaur tracks for years at their own Goddard Space Center in Maryland. The find came in 2012, when Ray Stanford was dropping off his wife for work and noticed the fossils just outside of the parking lot at the center. The study that was completed this month revealed an 8-foot-long slab full of prints, including prints from sauropods, pterosaurs, nodosaurs, and many mammals, including one mammal print that would have belonged to a species around the size of a badger. Throughout the Mesozoic, mammals were very small, and so this badger-sized species would have been among the largest mammals of the time period. With relatively few mammal finds from the time of dinosaurs, this find with a multitude of mammal tracks helps to give insight into how mammals diversified throughout the Cretaceous and during the Age of Dinosaurs. The Late Cretaceous of Africa has been a hard place for scientists to study, with dinosaur fossils specifically having been nearly unheard of. That changed this month, however, with a description of a titanosaur sauropod. Named Mansourasaurus, the species showed a lot of similarities to the Eurasian clade of sauropods, showing that Africa was not nearly as isolated as once believed during the Cretaceous. After the breakup of Pangaea and then the breakup of South America and Africa, was long believed to have been completely isolated until it finally reunited with Asia through the Arabian Peninsula. The finding of this dinosaur, and others like a French abelosaur, which has similarities to African species, shows that Africa was not nearly as isolated as once believed in the late Cretaceous, and that in fact, many species propagated between the continents. Complex feathers are even older than previously thought. Archaeopteryx is the longest known member of a group of dinosaurs called the Aviolae, which would eventually evolve into modern day birds. It was also the oldest known species until the discovery of Caihong Juji this year. Caihong sets the dates for complex feathers and for the group back 10 million years, from the time of Archaeopteryx 150 million years ago to the time that Caihong lived in 160 million years ago. Additionally, Caihong had longer and more densely arranged feathers than Archaeopteryx, giving indications that flight started early for dinosaurs. In the feathers, there were preserved melanosomes as well, helping to give us an insight into the color of Caihong. Darkly colored across its body, both bright, potentially iridescent plumage across its head and neck, much like a hummingbird. This is just another complex feature that early dinosaurs can add to their feathers. In more contemporary news, Yunnan County in China has opened a bidding process to open a dinosaur-based park inside of its township of Puyan. The head of the county has said that they aim to make a team of the top planners and paleontologists from around the world. In 2015, Puyan saw the discovery of a 150-meter-long dinosaur wall, which helped to give a lot of insights in the paleontological world to the evolutionary events that were happening in the early Jurassic. This park plans to be on that time period, making it a true Jurassic Park. Thanks for watching, everyone. It was really good to be able to do this and keep researching all of the new things that are happening in this new year. A lot of big finds already. If you have the time, Royal Tyrrell Museum has started their speaker series, which they are uploading online on their YouTube channel, which is in my featured channel, so you can watch longer talks about very specific studies that are being done. So feel free to watch those if you are interested. Take care, save the planet, don't go extinct.